An accident no one could have predicted, except a 13-year-old girl.
I had a dream. Kenny fell out of the van.
Find out what she saw and the hope it gave her parents on today's 700 Club Interactive.
On 700 Club Interactive, we use technology to pray for each other and explore topics that matter to you. Watch what God is doing in the world today.
Well, welcome to the show and thanks for joining us. Today, we're going to talk about prayer. And for many, prayer is often a last resort. It's what people turn to after they've lost all their other options. But for the Even family, it's what they turn to first after they found their son dying on the interstate.
I heard his head hit the pavement, and I heard the hollow sound. I just could not think of any scenario that my son would be alive.
Lance and Angela Even were driving their family home from an evening church service when Angela got an eerie feeling and asked the kids to check their seatbelts. Suddenly, the passenger side back door of their minivan slid open. Their 13-year-old son, Kenny, wasn't fastened in.
I heard the noise of the interstate, so I turned around to look.
When a van door opens, it's like a parachute. And I just saw Kenny just whipping around, being just catapulted out of the vehicle. And I slammed on the brakes, and the semi-truck hit us. Everything went in slow motion at that point.
About half a mile away from where the body fell, we came to a stop. And when I got to him, he was just laying in a fetal position. There was a pool of blood he was laying in.
Texts and calls were sent out almost immediately to pray for Kenny. Friends quickly arrived from their church nearby. Lance ran down the road to his son.
By the time I ran up and got to where Kenny was, my pastor was there holding my son, covered in my son's blood, praying for him. From that moment, we never were alone.
I put both arms around him and held him. Part of his face was gone, and there was a hole in the side of his cheek, the upper part of his cheek.
I guess very quickly realization set in that this is bigger than we can handle. And that's when I started to really cry out to God, and I said, God, we really, really need you.
Kenny flatlined several times while emergency crews prepared him for life flight to the hospital. Once there, he was placed on life support and not expected to live.
He was not breathing on his own, his heart was not beating, his brain was expanding with the pressure inside the brain increasing his heart. Everything was supported. He coded. At the time of admission, the prognosis was extremely poor.
Part of me did not want to believe what the doctor had to say. No, it's not no until God says it's final. And I said, Doc, I just want you to know that I've seen blind eyes seen. I've seen deafers hear. I watched the lame walk. And tonight, you and I are about to see God raise my son up from the dead. And I put my faith upon the word of God that he's going to raise my son up. We just need to wait this moment out.
From the first day, we said, we're going to fast, and we're going to pray for Kenny.
And we continue to pray. And pray.
That night, Kenny's twin sister, Kimberly, told her dad about a vision she had weeks before the accident.
She says, Dad, I saw all this.
I had a dream. Well, it was more of a nightmare. Kenny fell out of the van, and then he suddenly just started walking.
God was just showing us that he was in control. He spoke this in a dream to Kenny's twin sister. For our encouragement.
I guess just hearing that my son is going to walk again gave them enough reassurance to keep praying.
We weren't looking at the physical. We were standing on what God had said from his 13-year-old sister that Kenny was going to be all right.
Church members stood with the family in round-the-clock prayer and believed for Kenny's healing. But for now, Kenny remained in a coma.
medically it was starting to take impact on me, that possibly he's not in there. But inside of my heart and in my spirit, my faith believe another thing, that God is going to raise him up. And I said, God, for thou art the God of all flesh, is there anything too hard for you? You know how much I loved him. I said, my life will not be the same if he's not here. Can you breathe life back into my son's body?
5 days after the accident, Kenny showed no signs of improvement. Angela held Kenny's hand and talked to him. Then, she says, the miraculous happened.
He squeezed my hand, and it was a moment of excitement, and I just said, you squeezed my hand. And I put my hand again into Kenny's hand, and I said, Kenny, if that was you that squeezed my hand, would you please do it again? And he gentle, very faint, a slight move. And it was a moment of victory. My son is alive. He's in there. God is beginning to do something.
The doctors did not believe. And every time something would happen, a squeeze on the hand or something, they'd say, oh, that's just a reflex. But we knew better, because it was in conjunction to what we were doing. We knew God could raise the dead. We knew God can heal the sick.
The miracles continued to come. A few days later, Kenny opened his eyes.
It was a wonderful thing to see him look at me and open his eyes for a moment, and I talked to him, and his eyebrows got real big, like, yes, I understand you. And we kept telling him, you are getting better. Trust God. Kenny, you need to be praying. You need to be seeking the Lord. You need to be calling on God's healing. You've been in an accident. And he would squeeze our hand, like he would know, yes, I am praying.
Kenny progressively regained consciousness. Now questions remained regarding the extent of brain damage Kenny had sustained. Until one afternoon, Angela gave Kenny her laptop. He logged into Facebook and sent a message to a friend. Kenny was back.
God had restored him fully. He had raised him up from the dead, give him back his memory. The devil couldn't steal that from him.
The very next thing I remember is just waking up in the hospital thinking I was in someone's room. At the time, I just was looking around wondering, how did I get here? Mom looked up at me and was just amazed that I was actually talking. I'm like, Mom, all I'm doing is talking. I do this every day. And she looked up at me, you're still the same Kenny. And like, rubbed my head.
To the amazement of the doctors, 32 days after the accident, Kenny walked out of the hospital on his own 2 feet, healed.
From where we saw him in the ER and the ICU to where he is now, if this is not a miracle, I don't know what would be.
When Kenny was leaving the hospital, they all stood and applauded as he walked away.
Kenny's family encourage others to put their trust in Jesus and never stop praying.
God answers prayer, and it's wonderful to be there and to see it in such a dynamic way.
I got to see Jesus face to face and experience the resurrection power of Jesus Christ.
I've come to a new plateau, a new era in my life of knowing God even more.
You just have to stay with God. You have to keep believing. He will watch after you and watch over you.
True words never spoken. You have to stay with God and keep believing. Even the disciples of Jesus had questions about, did they pray properly? And so they asked him to teach us to pray. And here's this piece illustrates some signature points that we have to keep in mind as in the middle of disaster, in the middle of terrible illness, where you're wondering, is my child going to make it? What do you hold on to, and what do you believe? Well, the first thing, it comes out of Isaiah 53, verse 1. Who has believed our report, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? When you start understanding that when the doctors come in with a negative, then which report are you going to believe? Are you going to believe the report of the Lord, or are you going to believe the report of the doctor? Or are you going to buy into the negative? Because if you do, oh, then you're going to doubt. And if you come to God doubting, realize the Bible says you're not going to get anything. So whose report will you believe? And the Bible asks, who has believed our report, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? The two are linked. See, who believes the report of the Lord is the same person that the arm of the Lord is revealed. So if you believe, then you get the result. You get the arm of the Lord. You get the action of the Lord. That gets revealed to you because you first believed Him. And that's what this wonderful family did. They said, okay, the doctors are saying this thing, but I know a God, and I know that that God opens the eyes of the blind. I know that God is able to heal the deaf. I know He's able to raise my son from the dead. That's the kind of faith that God is looking for. And the Bible says His eyes go to and fro over the whole earth to show Himself strong to them whose hearts are loyal to Him. So that's what happens. That's the thing that's released when you say, I believe the report of the Lord. And this isn't something that you do from what I call mental assent. It's what you do from your innermost being. That when in your innermost being you say, that report is not right, the report of the Lord is the one that's right, and that's the one I'm going to cling to. Now, how do you get that? How do you get that innermost faith, the knowing in your knower, as opposed to some kind of intellectual faith that says, yes, I know the Bible says that, but you know and are able to act on what you know because you know it from an experience with a living God. Here it is from Romans chapter 10, verse 17. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. When the Word of God is so quickened to you that it's in your gut, then when it's in your heart, and then it just flows out of your mouth, that's the faith the Bible's talking about. It's not something where you say, okay, mentally I agree. It's something where everything in you says, I believe. Now, I'd like to add to Romans 10 that faith comes by hearing and hearing by the Word. Then I'd like to add, who is the Word? And when you understand Jesus is the Word, that the two are inseparable, that He, because He backs up His Word and He puts His Word as, this is, I will perform it, it's me. Then you look to Jesus, the author and the finisher of your faith. When you hear it coming from Him, then you have all the faith you need. Now, this family got something extra. They got a 13-year-old girl who had a dream. And it's interesting how they framed that, because they use the word dream, they use the word vision, and then she uses the word nightmare, all of which points to something in the Bible. We find it in Genesis 46, verse 2. Then God spoke to Israel in the visions of the night and said, Jacob, Jacob, and he said, here I am. Now, this is a crucial time in his life. He's already been named Israel. He's already wrestled with God and prevailed. He already knows his Redeemer. He already knows the promise given to Abraham and Isaac that you and your descendants will occupy the nation of Israel. This land, the promised land, is given to you. But he's facing a decision, and the decision is, it's a starvation time. And his son Joseph is in Egypt as a prince who's able to feed Jacob and all of his family. And he's invited him to come to Egypt to wait out the 7 years of famine. Now, we know the end of the story. It turned out to be a lot more than 7 years, and it turned into 400, and it was a bit of a nightmare for the children of Israel, their sojourn into Egypt. But this time was the time where God was going to save them from starvation. And so he assured Jacob in the night And he said to him, I'm here. And then he promises him, I'm going to watch over you. And that's what happened with this family, where the 13-year-old girl said, yes, I saw in my nightmare, in my vision of the night, I saw my brother, my twin, taken and sucked out of the car. But then I saw him walking. And that was the promise that saw them through. In your time of difficulty, are you keeping your ears open to hear from God? Are you asking him to show you the way out? Because the Bible says, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. When you understand he's there, and he wants to show his arms strong towards you, and all it takes for you is to continue to believe and then seek him. And if you're not getting enough faith from reading the words of the Bible, ask him. Ask him, Lord, I need more faith. I need a word of knowledge. I need a word of wisdom. I need a dream. I need a vision to see me through this. And if you ask that with all of your heart, he'll answer. What he's done for thousands of years, he will do for you if you just believe. Now, if you need prayer, if you need someone to agree with you in prayer and claim the great promises of God, all you have to do is call us. Numbers toll free, 888-777-1999. It's our honor, it's our privilege to pray for you. So if you are in distress, if you need someone just to agree, now's the time to do it. Call us, 888-777-1999. Well, up next, a young orphan girl falls ill. Find out how her caretakers found the key to her healing right after this.
In 2008, my husband Gary departed for heaven. I was still grieving. And then to find out I had cancer, I began praying, God, how do I do this? Where do I do this? Cancer Treatment Centers of America was the place. Dr. Neelam outlined a plan that would take care of my mind and my body, and she prayed with me.
For Bible-believing Christians, we're able to pray with them in a much deeper way as they begin to really rely upon their faith.
At Cancer Treatment Centers of America, we believe in the power of faith and prayer as indispensable allies in the fight against complex and advanced stage cancer.
I'm back in Telluride on the mountain skiing. I feel strong and healthy.
Advanced medicine and technology.
And I am a survivor.
The warm embrace of the spirit and the power of prayer.
These are happy tears.
Please go to cancercenter.com/faith. Appointments available now. Cancer Treatment Centers of America, care that never quits.
Today, Neon lives in a safe, warm home surrounded by loving friends who take care of her. Not long ago, this little girl was living on the streets, completely alone.
When Neon was 2, she wandered the streets of Vietnam with her father. They were homeless.
I don't remember much from when my dad was alive. I was very young, but people here tell me stories about him.
Overnight, Neon had become an orphan with nowhere to go. So she came to live here at this Christian home for children supported by CBN's Orphans Promise.
When I first arrived at the center, there were so many children. I was excited to meet them. They are all my friends now.
But one day, Neon fell ill with a super virus that had been spreading across her country. The doctor said she would have a high fever for at least 10 days and possible complications afterwards. That's when the Christian staff members started to pray for her. Remarkably, the next morning, Neon's fever was gone, and she was up playing with her best friend. Neon knows exactly who to thank for that answered prayer.
It was Jesus Christ who healed me.
And thanks to the gifts of CBN partners, Neon will have a place to call home for as long as she needs it.
Thank you, CBN.
Thank you. If you're a member of the 700 Club, you're part of blessing that little girl. If you're not a member, join with us. We're reaching out with hands of love and compassion around the world. In Vietnam, as you just saw, in Thailand, Laos. We're even going into Myanmar, Indonesia, the Philippines, China, India. We're doing it throughout Africa, throughout Latin America. We're doing it because people like you care enough to give. A portion of every gift goes into the work of CBN International to help people around the world. Another portion goes into broadcasting the gospel so that we train local Christians how to do Christian television so we can get the good news out about what Jesus is doing today in their culture with people that look like them, talk like them. We want to make it culturally relevant to reach that society now, and you make it possible when you join with us. If you're not a member, call the toll-free number, 888-777-1999. Just say, I want to join the 700 Club. It's just $20 a month, 65 cents a day, and you join with tens of thousands of people that say yes. They want to make a difference in the world today. If that's you, call us, 888-777-1999. Still ahead on the program, the youngest driver ever to win the Daytona 500.
So that's who I wanted to be. I wanted to be the young guy coming in and winning races.
I don't even know where to go.
And you realize you just won the biggest race that there is to win.
Daytona champion Trevor Bayne talks about his role model after this.
If you're the mother of a child with behavior problems, I'd like to talk to you. My name is Janet Lehman, and I'm a behavioral therapist and a mom. I know what it's like when the child that you love becomes a defiant, out-of-control child who disrespects you.
That's why my husband James and I created the Total Transformation, the program that tens of thousands of moms are now using to turn around their child's behavior.
If you've heard about the Total Transformation and wondered if it will work for you, now you can try it for free. I'm willing to give away 1,000 programs today for free.
All you need to do is get the program and let us know how it works for you. We'll let you keep it for free.
I know the Total Transformation works because I used these techniques with my own son and with troubled kids for over 30 years. Let me prove to you that it works by giving you the program free.
Call the number on your screen now to get the Total Transformation free.
What is wrong with you?
I thought adoption would be easier than this.
You just don't know what to do.
Being a foster or adoptive parent can be very difficult. I know. I've been there. That's why Orphans Promise developed Adoption and Foster RX, Solutions for Wounded Families. In this DVD series, parenting experts take on the tough issues and offer proven strategies. Don't miss this vital information. Call now, because there is hope for wounded families.
In 2011, Trevor Bayne won the Daytona 500. At 20 years old, he became the youngest driver ever to win the Great American Race. Sports reporter Sean Brown talked with Trevor about his fast track to fame and the faith that keeps him going when the going gets tough.
It's over.
At the ripe old age of 21, Trevor Bayne is still a kid at heart.
I go eat my peanut butter and jelly sandwich, and it's pretty chaotic at the races, actually.
Just 2 days after he turned 20, Bayne became the youngest driver to win the Daytona 500.
So that's who I wanted to be. I wanted to be the young guy coming in and winning races. It felt like a dream. I mean, because you don't feel anything, and you're just like looking at the flag, pulling down the victory lane.
I don't even know where to go.
And you realize you just won the biggest race that there is to win.
Do you feel strange driving on a normal street after going 190?
A little bit, but it doesn't seem that fast when you're racing until you start to crash. And when you crash, you realize that the wall is coming up really fast, and you're going a lot faster than you think. But then you get on the interstate, and you want to go a little bit fast sometimes, so you got to keep it in check.
So do you get speed tickets?
I've had a couple, but none of them too crazy. They're all like the silly 5 miles an hour, 10 miles an hour
okay,
over, you know,
okay.
The ones that really make you frustrated.
None reckless.
No, too reckless. No, okay. I try to be careful on the roads.
He started racing go-karts at the age of 5 and has been on the winning streak for more than half of his life. But Trevor says his Christian upbringing helped him stay level-headed about his numerous successes.
I grew up, you know, hearing about God and knowing about Jesus, but I guess it was around middle school when God started working on my heart and started showing me why Jesus came to earth and, you know, who I am in Him.
Some compare him to another role model in the world of sports.
I read a recent article that said that, hey, you want to be like Tim Tebow, which I, after talking to you, I don't think that's exactly the case. But talk about it a little bit.
You know, we are supposed to mold ourselves and look like Jesus and walk as he did and have him to change our lives. So when there's two guys that are modeling themselves after the same person, then they're going to look a lot alike. You know, I think Tim Tebow is a great guy, and he's a great role model for kids to look up to. But that's not my only role model. You know, my role model is Jesus, and that's who I want to be like.
Like Tebow, Bain gives all the credit to God.
God's just drawing us closer to him in every experience, and that's what we prayed about before the race. Whether it was a good result or a bad result, we'd just be drawn closer. And he taught me something yesterday, you know, in that race. And you never know what his plan is, but I can guarantee if you stick with him, he's going to have something good for you.
I pray and I just say, you know, whatever God has for us that day, let us have the best of our ability. Let us do everything that we can to do our best. But if it's not our day to win, then we won't win. But, you know, there's very few times that I pray for favor, but sometimes I do. Sometimes I pray to win, and I think that was one of those days.
Trevor's faith was challenged after his big win at Daytona when he was forced out of racing for 5 weeks. He spent time in the hospital, most likely suffering from Lyme disease.
On Twitter, I got on there after I won the 500 and I was like, you know, God is so good, this is awesome. So I'm laying there in the hospital bed and that started sinking in. So I go on Twitter and I just tweeted out, I'm like, you know what, I'm in the hospital, but God is still good, you know. But if it's for that one person to see that things aren't always perfect, that we're going to go through struggles, but Christ is still right there, not changing. That's what that's all about. And so I think there's something we can learn out of everything, and that was really what I learned through that.
He surrounds himself with a team that helps build his faith and has taken time to write down encouraging thoughts as they come to him.
I got on my phone, I just started writing down like whatever I was thinking about, and got some pretty good stuff out of it.
You still got it on your phone. Could you read that?
I do. I have it. You know, I'm not exactly a great writer or anything, but this is just kind of the thoughts that I had when I was sitting there. Keep me humble. I'm no longer racing for worldly advantages or things. I'm racing for the kingdom. I drive to bring glory to Christ, and I'll give him 100% in all that I do. This means the desire to win is not only okay, but necessary. Not for my name's sake, though. Not for me to gain the world or more fans, but for Jesus' name to be known. My heart, eyes, and mind will be set on heaven, and there alone I'll store my treasures.
Did it work?
It's working so far. I got to go back and read it every now and then, but I think it's important, man, just to, when he gives us something, write it down. You know, I've been doing that a lot more, and it's helped me, so.
His biography, Driven by Faith, teaches kids about NASCAR while telling them about his relationship with Jesus Christ.
It's cool when you can think about that you're racing something bigger than a trophy. For me, when I think about it being for the kingdom purposes and having treasures in heaven and not just here, that's pretty big, man. That's cool, you know, that we get to race for him and he's glorified in it. Like, I'm doing what I love to do and he's receiving glory for it.
Whatever the future has in store for number 21, big or small, Trevor Bain plans to stay focused on God.
You know, that 500 was great for the day or for the last month after that. Well, that was something that I'll never forget. But something that's going to stay with me a lot longer is Christ and that relationship and that choice to be, you know, open my heart and say, here's my life, you know, use it.
Here's my life, use it. Wonderful words coming from someone so very young to have that much wisdom. You just, you know, look at it and go, praise God, he's going to have a wonderful career. Now, listen to what Trevor said, and I think it's important for all Christians to understand that. When you become a Christian, life is not going to be perfect for you. There are going to be struggles. I mean, here Trevor, he went through a car accident, he's in the hospital, and he said, my life is not perfect, but I hold on to what is perfect, and that is Jesus Christ. And when you get that straight, that you know, life doesn't always turn out the way you plan, but when you put your faith in him, then you get the results. Well, this is 700 Club Interactive, where we interact with you. Let's go over to Dimitri in the chat room.
Yes, Gordon, Cindy asks, what is the difference between saying your prayers versus meaningful prayers? Does that mean God hears some of the prayers but not others?
God hears everything. I mean, he's omniscient, so he's going to hear it all. The issue is, are you praying with your full heart? Jesus warned about the prayer of the heathen, that they repeated prayers over and over and over again. And so if you're doing some kind of speed prayer or you're doing a prayer based on some sense of duty, I wouldn't expect to get too much of an answer out of that one. But when you pray with your heart and say, God, this is what I need and I believe in you, then you get the answer. We leave with this word from James chapter 5, confess your trespasses to one another, pray for one another, that you may be healed. The effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much.